Hi, this is Janet Dafoe doing our fifth interview about MECFS research updates. And this one is about Ron Davis and his lab and what's going on in the lab. And in this case, it's about work that's being done by Peidong Shen, who works on RNA and DNA technologies and is kind of a genius on the topic. And I found out that Ron is excited about several of the things that Peidong is doing. And my goal is to share with you what Ron's excited about. So Ron, take it away.
Well, you heard in the last video about the attackinate pathway. And that seems very exciting because it explains an awful lot about what's happening in the patients. However, that pathway has to be on, and it must be on for a very long time for patients to be suffering for a long time.
The attackinate shunt has to be operating,
correct?
Right?
Okay. Correct. And that pathway comes on when you have an infection. So one possibility is there's some infection that's persistent in patients for a very long time. And so we need to look for it. And we have looked for it in the past simply because the patients look like they might have an infection. But now it's more serious because now we see a molecular mechanism that can explain an awful lot of what's happening in the patients. So Peidong has worked out a number of tests to look for infections. And I've talked about some of this in the past. And he's looking at for viruses at the present time. And he has made, he's developed a technology that we call multiplexing because there's a lot of viruses and with a lot of people we have to test. So with the multiplexing, he can test a lot of viruses in a single tube. So we can do lots of patients, each of them being in a different tube. He's even worked out ways to combine patients, but we're not going to do that in this case. So he has developed this for a lot of the herpes, for all of the herpes viruses and any other DNA virus that might be a candidate. And he's also developed this for doing RNA. It's a little more difficult. The major one we want to look for is enterovirus. So he has run this herpes test on about 50 patients. We do see occasional activation of the herpes, but it's not common, and it's not much different than healthy people. So it doesn't look like that's the answer at the present time. He's also looked at RNA, but not extensively. He's made probes for the enteroviruses, and probably there is there's a lot of different enteroviruses. So he's chosen sequences that are very conserved in the enteroviruses, in hopes that that will work. He also doesn't do just one probing for each virus. He will do 10 for each virus. So that helps to get rid of the false positive, false negative issues. He's done about, I think, 20 samples for enterovirus, and he didn't find any. Now that's in the blood. The possibility, of course, is that it's not in the blood, it's somewhere else. So we're going to do a sample from my son, because he has a J-tube, and we have a tube into his stomach, so we can pull contents out of his stomach without being invasive, and we'll test that for enterovirus. Now, there's other things that could be infections that we need to look at. And parasites is one thing because they can stay around for a very long time. So he has been working on making the probes for the parasites. We've done a little piloting from those, but he's not ready to do a big analysis yet. These will include the trypanosomes. We also have one patient that seems to have nematodes in the blood. And so we have been working on, but that organism has not been sequenced. And so we've been working on getting the sequence of that organism so we can probe that in other patients. Now, another sort of a side issue because we can do this, is with the COVID infection, patients come down with long COVID, which looks exactly like MACFS in my book. So we got Open Medicine Foundation got money from another foundation to do some experiments. And one of the things that we said we would do would be to look for the activation of the herpes viruses. Our samples have now come in from Sweden, and we have been looking at those samples.
From Jonas Bergqvist?
From Jonas Bergqvist, correct. We have done 20 of those samples, just as a beginning. And we do find, we found EBV activated in those the 18 of those 20 samples. The two that were negative, we'll look at again, and we'll do more of those samples. Now that's just EBV as a pilot. We'll now go back and do all the herpes viruses and see if it's just EBV or are there other herpes viruses that are activated as well. Now, this technology can be used to sequence genes. You can amplify a whole bunch of regions.
What does amplify mean?
Oh, the amplify means that, in order to do this, we can't just take a very tiny amount of DNA and analyze it. What we do is we actually synthesize the DNA, and amplify means you do it over and over again. So you have one molecule and now you have 10 million sequences. And then that we can then use in more conventional methods. And so there's a number of genes that we think may be very important in the patients. And one of them is looking at the Bh4 pathway. Bh4 has been implicated with a number of other scientists. And there's a possibility that there are mutations in the gene or in the control regions for the gene. And so there's a number of genes that we need to look at in this to do this pathway. So Peidong has made probes to march down the whole gene and all the control regions for a number of things. Now, in general,
you mean looking for a number of things?
Well, yeah, he will look for defects or things that would cause the gene to not work as well.
Okay.
And mostly what we're suspecting would be genes that have the enzyme either be at low level or be not working very well. And so this will be easy to do once we get it all set up. It's much more efficient than doing whole genome sequencing. It's also more accurate because what we can do with this is to cover the region more extensively.
So when you say enzyme, is Bh4 an enzyme?
No, Bh4 is a small molecule and it's made by enzymes in the body.
And you're looking for the DNA that codes for that enzyme.
For the enzymes, right.
And things that might be wrong in making that enzyme. Right. Okay.
And so the patients might have lower level of Bh4, and that's one of the hypotheses about some of the causes of MACFS. So we're going to get much more involved in that. Also, Bh4 is not easily analyzed in the sense it's a very unstable molecule. It's easily oxidized. So generally speaking, people do not measure the concentration of it. So we're setting up assays to actually measure the level of Bh4 and also some of the other products, like the oxidized form of Bh4 is also going to be done. So it'll be not only the genetics, but the metabolomics, of this. And maybe we'll get some insights about how Bh4 might be important in this pathway. Oh, the last thing is that with this technology, we can also look for the messenger RNAs that make the enzymes in the attackinate pathway. And so that's now being done. We are currently looking at looking for those enzymes in cells from the blood. that may not be the best place to look. It's just that it's a place where you can get cells. We have a collaborator in at Harvard that will send us some muscle samples from patients. There'll be tiny amounts, but it would be enough because we can amplify to look for them in muscle.
Can you say his name?
Well, I haven't permission to do that, so I didn't want to do it.
Okay, sorry.
And we don't have it yet. when we get it and we do this, some of the tests, I will make sure we can talk about it. But it's hard to get human samples because it's invasive.
That aren't blood, you mean?
That's not blood. Blood is not considered invasive, but everything else is considered invasive, and it's really difficult to get permission and to be able to do those samples.
So what are you most excited about with this work?
I'm most excited because it is probing whether the attackinate pathway is on. Oh, there is one last thing I didn't mention, and that is it's possible that the herpes viruses are activated, but they don't replicate. So our assay is DNA, so it requires the virus to be replicated. The virus DNA to be replicated and making virus particles. But it may just simply turn on even a single RNA molecule, and that RNA molecule could look like an infection. And that could be
into the body?
And it's in the body, right? So
look like to whom?
To the body.
Okay.
So it could look like there is an infection. And so that would then be a trigger to trigger the attackinate pathway. And as long as that RNA keeps being made, the pathway possibly will stay on.
And that means that a virus could be activated, but you might not be able to find virus particles or DNA of it, which might explain why nobody's been able to find the virus in people's blood, or most people haven't been able to.
And Prashti is the one who suggested that there may be an RNA made. And I think that's a really good idea. And
the point of that is, if there's an RNA made, it means the virus is activated, but it's not fully functioning.
That's right.
Like
an infection.
Right.
But it may look like an infection to the body because there's a foreign RNA molecule present.
Okay.
So that's, to me, very exciting. We really have to rigorously test and try to figure out if the attackinate pathway is on, and if it is on, why is it on?
So in the past, I'm going to go back a little bit. In the past, you'd made a big effort to find viruses in the blood, and you basically couldn't find any DNA viruses. And you talked about how Peidong was going to create a method to look for RNA viruses, and people have been waiting to see if you can do that and if you find the enteroviruses. Right. And you've talked about that in this talk.
Yes.
And we're a little bit past that because you don't have to find the whole operating virus or particles of it. You just need to find that it's been reactivated and that you're finding the RNA. Now, did I get that right?
No, because the RNA viruses generally don't integrate into the host. I mean, some do, but
the host,
well, the person. So there are some of the sort of cancer viruses that can do that, but generally speaking, they're not dormant in the genome of people.
So where are we with looking for enteroviruses and trying to connect with?
I did talk about the fact that he has made these probes for enterovirus. We have done a preliminary analysis for that. I think he's only done 20 patients at the moment and hasn't found anything in the blood. And that's why we have to go to other sites. That will be repeated with more samples. And we have to make sure that it's working. But I think that where it's been found before in patients is in the stomach.
By Dr. Chia.
And Dr. Chia. So we need to look at that and have a better way to find that.
So the update on the past stuff is what you've just said, which is the method has been developed to look for RNA viruses, and he's done it in about 20 right. people, and that's ongoing.
And more RNA viruses will be looked at. There's a lot of RNA viruses, and it's a little more difficult to do.
And then the most exciting thing that you're talking about today is that this DNA RNA technology that Peidong has developed is going to enable you to possibly find evidence of reactivated viruses
right.
that could be triggering the interferon alpha and the attackinate pathway to go on.
Right.
Okay.
Oh, and the nice thing about that is that we could probably figure out a way to shut it off.
That would be great. And I think right. Rob Fair is going to talk about that as soon as he's ready to do that. So now I'm going to lighten this up for a little bit and show you normal Ron Davis right here. This is a normal Ron Davis. And now I'm going to say, Ron Davis, are you excited?
Yes.
And he's going to say that. And there you have the excited Ron Davis. And it's amazing because they look the same. So whenever all of you are making inferences about Ron Davis being excited on videos, you're going to have to just wait for me to tell you if he's excited or not, or listen to his words, because you can't tell from looking at him. Okay. And I'm telling you, that's the excited Ron Davis. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yes, I'm excited.
Okay. Thank you very much for listening, and we'll see you next time. This is a postscript, and I wanted to get Ron to talk about who funded this work.
The funding started with the Open Medicine Foundation, where we started developing the probes for doing the amplification and sequencing from the DNA viruses. And then it was when we started the attackinate pathway that was funded by Vinod. He picked up this.
Vinod Khosla.
He picked up this project as well. So this has now been totally funded by Vinod Khosla.
It is now, all the work being done now is funded by him, but the previous work was funded by OMF. And we are very grateful to OMF and all the people who work there, and all the donations from the patients and their loved ones and from Vinod to make this work possible. Thank you so much.